The following information introduced Einstein and his special theory of relativity in a very simple way and concentrates on two of them. First, they pinpoint the daring conceptual leaps that lay at the heart of Einstein's theory. Einstein was not a great mathematician, and his discoveries all begin with creative insights that can be understood and appreciated without jargon. For philosophers, these flights of genius are enduring moments to the beauty and power of thought. Secondly, the data returns constantly to the heated controversy now surrounding the interpretation of Einstein's theories. Despite the myriad of successful predictions they produce, there is now real uncertainty about why his theories work, and therefore about his grand revisions in our ideas about space and time. This approach is unusual. Most introductions to relativity hide the ongoing debates and concentrate on expounding the technical features of Einstein's theory. Here, the mathematics is set aside and we stay close to the phenomena, to the concrete predictions and observable implications of the theory. Thus, we penetrate to the conceptual core of theory and therefore to its philosophical heart. Later in his life, Einstein distinguished between two sorts of scientific theories. Constructive theories begin by listing the basic things in the world and build up or construct larger, high-level things from these. The fully developed model is then used to make predictions. Philosophers would say that such a theory begins with an ontology and draws consequences from it. In contrast, Einstein said special relativity is a principal theory. He meant that the theory begins by listing a few high-level assumptions or isolated facts that are not supported by any model, and then uses these to make predictions. The truth of the predictions would justify the assumptions or justify relying on the facts, even if they are not clearly supported by a deeper picture of the world. A principal theory can seem very mysterious when the predictions it makes are unexpected. When a magician pulls a rabbit out of an ordinary-looking hat, we seek for some deeper explanation of what happened. A principal theory does not offer deeper explanations. The central mystery is light. It is, first of all, astonishingly fast. With a flick of a switch, light floods a room. Before the rise of modern science, it was sometimes thought that light leapt magically across space without taking any time at all. This changed, however, after Galileo first turned a telescope towards the skies in 1609. Clever astronomers realized they could use the regular orbits of Jupiter's moons as giant clocks and were able to measure the speed of light with surprising accuracy. The numbers they produced shocked most people. Who could conceive of a speed of 186,000 miles per second, or 300,000 kilometers per second? But another more perplexing surprise lay in wait. The speed of light is constant. That is, all observers who measure the speed of light in empty space will find the same number no matter how fast they are moving. An observer standing still will find starlight racing by at 300,000 kilometers per second. A spaceship cruising at 200,000 kilometers per second and chasing a light beam will still find that the beam races away from the nose of the ship at 300,000 kilometers per second. This means, for example, that no one can race fast enough to catch a light beam. No matter how fast someone is moving, light will be faster by 300,000 kilometers per second. This is very peculiar. By way of contrast, considering a speeding motorist being chased along a road by the police. At the start, the police car at a standstill at the side of the road the speeding car zips away at 150 kilometers per hour. As the police car reaches 30 kilometers per hour, the speeding car travels only 120 kilometers per hour faster. As they accelerate, the relative speed of the fugitive drops down further and further, and finally dwindles to zero as the police car catches up and races alongside, flashing their lights. This is common sense. If the speeding car goes at 150 kilometers per hour and the police are chasing at 130 kilometers per hour, then their relative speed is 20 kilometers per hour. But light is not common sense. Light races away from any standing or moving body at the same speed. The speed of light relative to any moving body is a constant. This fact was discovered experimentally in the late 1800s. It was so strange, there was no agreement about what it meant, or even whether the experiments could be correct. Even today, we have no deep explanation of why the speed of light is constant. Many have derived the fact, but only by making other equally mysterious assumptions. It was Einstein's great achievement to see this bizarre fact as a clue. He was able to place it at the center of a powerful new theory and thus opened up a new vision of our universe. Someone might mistakenly think that the constancy of the speed of light leads to contradictions and therefore cannot be true. For example, suppose there are two rockets traveling through space in the same direction, but at different speeds, and that there is a ray of light racing out ahead of them. Someone might think that light cannot travel 300,000 kilometers per second faster than each rocket, because the light beam would then have two speeds. But that would be a contradiction. Light cannot have two different speeds. What is wrong with this reasoning? Einstein was able to remove the appearance of contradiction by profoundly altering our view of time. To understand this, we must carefully reconsider what a contradiction would be. Plato and Aristotle were apparently the first to state what is perhaps the most fundamental idea in philosophy: the law of non-contradiction. Opposite properties do not belong to one and the same thing in the same respect and at the same time. According to this law, a positive integer is never both even and odd. A paper can be black and white and red all over, but not in the same respect. It can be black here and white there and red throughout. It cannot be black and white at the same point, since these colors are opposite. In a move of breathtaking audacity, Einstein reasoned that since there were no real contradictions, and therefore a light beam cannot have two speeds at the same respect at the same time, the two rockets above must have different times. That is, the rockets each measure the same relative speed for the light beam because time flows differently for each rocket. A little story will help make this more concrete. Suppose that Jill is an astronaut flying overhead through the starry night. Jack is earthbound and working in mission control, and it is his job to monitor Jill and her spaceship carefully through a large telescope. As Jill's spaceship approaches the speed of light, Jack observes something marvelous. Jill and everything in the spaceship move in slow motion, like a film in the cinema shown at a slowed rate. The hands on Jill's wristwatch begin to crawl around the clock face. She seems to be wading through molasses. The half-hour program she is watching on her television takes 45 minutes. Jack is not surprised because Einstein predicted this. As the rocket speeds up, its time flows more slowly than here on Earth. An hour on the rocket is longer than an hour on Earth. This is now called time dilation. To dilate is to become wider or longer. and there is a simple formula to predict how much Jill's time will slow when her rocket has a particular speed. Reasoning from the constancy of the speed of light, Einstein concluded that there was no single universal passage of time. Rather, that the flow of time depends on speeds. Faster speeds means longer hours. Each body moving through space experiences the flow of time at a different rate. This astonishing conclusion was confirmed by many experiments. One experiment by Haffel and Keating in 1971 used exactly accurate atomic clocks, which were carried on around-the-world flights in Boeing jets. Although the jets flew much more slowly than the speed of light, there was still a measurable time dilation. The clocks were slightly behind other clocks that remained in the laboratory, just as Einstein's theory predicted. This can be tested at home. For example, time dilation can be used to delay getting the wrinkled hands that accompany aging. If both hands are simply flapped up and down, continuously at nearly the speed of light, they will remain young while the rest of your body ages. Many studying relativity theory for the first time assume these effects are some kind of illusion that arise because of the way fast-moving objects are observed. That is, they believe that durations are really constant and merely appear to vary with speeds because they must be observed from far away. Some believe it is the lag time, the time it takes for light to travel from the object to the measurement device that produces an illusion. This is easy to refute and cannot be correct. For example, when the traveling atomic clocks were returned to the laboratory bench, the slight discrepancy between them and the stay-at-home clocks could be read off immediately. No fancy apparatus or fast-moving objects were involved. Indeed, human observers are unnecessary. A computer could have registered and printed out the differences. Similar examples of relativistic effects are widespread in the daily work of experimental physicists. Almost everyone in the present debate agrees that the effects cannot be simple illusions. Likewise, some beginners mistakenly believe that time dilation is just a consequence of using different units of measurement. A measurement assigns a number to a distance or a duration. A tennis court is 24 meters or 78 feet long. A tennis match may last 3 hours or 180 minutes. These numbers obviously depend on conventional units of measurement, on, say, whether meters or feet are used. When international organizations change the definition of the units, the numbers assigned to bodies change too. But time dilation occurs even when everyone agrees on and uses the same units of measurement. Jack and Jill compare their rulers and synchronize their watches before the spaceship leaves Earth. Even so, Jill's watch will run more slowly relative to Jack's when she increases her speed. In short, time dilation is a real effect and is neither an illusion nor a difference in the choice of measurement units. The flow of time depends on speeds. If two rockets flying at different speeds are chasing the same light beam, the light will indeed travel 300,000 kilometers per second faster than each ship. But there is no contradiction. The light beam has opposite properties, but not at the same time. Each ship has its own time. When Einstein published his ideas about time dilation in 1905, he limited his predictions to a special case, to special sorts of measurements. As mentioned above, special relativity is special because it is limited to special cases. To understand these important limitations, we must consider some simple facts about motion. Suppose a ship is sailing very smoothly down a wide river at a constant speed and in a fixed direction. Suppose some budget travelers have cabins below deck without windows, and so cannot see the riverbanks sliding slowly by the ship. When they wake up in the morning, such passengers will not be able to tell whether the ship is moving or standing still. In fact, no observation or experiment performed within the cabin can measure the ship's motion. Without looking outside, steady speeds are undetectable and unmeasurable. This is very peculiar. If the passengers are really moving, they should be able to discover it without looking elsewhere. Philosophers and scientists discussed this riddle so often that they gave steady motion a special name. Distances and durations are measured with rulers and clocks. Einstein limited his special theory to the case where the rulers and clocks used in measurements were at rest or moving inertially. In short, the special theory applies only to inertial measurements. The object that is measured may be accelerating. It may be turning loops or flapping up and down, but the measuring device must be resting or moving steadily. We can now state Einstein's claims about time dilation more precisely. Time dilation. Take as a standard a clock that is at rest or moving inertially. Other clocks moving relative to the standard will have longer hours, i.e. dilated hours. Furthermore, all physical processes moving relative to the standard clock will take longer than if they were at rest relative to the standard. That is, it will take more than an hour on the inertial standard clock for an hour to pass on a clock moving relative to it, or, for example, for a moving video player on the spaceship to show an hour-long program. The special theory can be applied to accelerating measuring devices by using approximations. If the period of acceleration is divided into short intervals, the device can be treated as moving inertially during each interval. By adding the changes during each of these intervals together, the change during the entire acceleration can be approximated. But strictly speaking, the special theory applies only to measurements made by devices moving at constant speeds in a straight line. Einstein's central idea is that there is democracy among all inertial measurements. Any measurement made by a set of rulers and clocks moving at a steady speed in a fixed direction is equally as good as a measurement made by any other set. Suppose that there are two sets of rulers and clocks moving relatively to each other, and each is measuring the speed of a passing spaceship. The results of the measurements will differ, but Einstein insists each result may equally claim to be the speed of the ship. There is no physical way to show that one speed is more correct than the other. Suppose that the budget travelers below deck on the ship work hard to discover their speed by doing all sorts of experiments inside their cabin. For example, they drop objects and discover that they fall faster and faster the longer they fall. In fact, every second of fall increases their speed by 32 feet per second. This law is the same in the cabin as it would be on shore. That is, even laws of physics are unaffected by the ship's speed through the river. Thus, Einstein's democracy extends even to laws. They are the same for all observers moving at steady speeds in a fixed direction. Einstein called this sort of democracy his special principle of relativity. The laws of physics are the same for all observers moving at a steady speed along a straight line. That is, regardless of your relative speed, the laws of physics are the same. As Einstein said, this postulate we call the special principle of relativity. The word special is meant to intimate that the principle is restricted to the case where the measuring devices have a motion of uniform translation and does not extend to the case of non-uniform motion. What is a law of physics? When we plan a journey by car, we use the simple law that distance equals speed multiplied by time. An average of 90 kilometers an hour for 5 hours will cover 450 kilometers. Here we have a law that connects three things: distance, speed, and time. Each of these can easily be measured with, say, the speedometer of the car, a wristwatch, and a good map. This suggests that a law is a relation between measurements. The relation in this law is represented by the italicized words above. In every motion, the relation between distance traversed, speed, and time taken will be the same. Some laws contain constants. For example, when we drop something on the floor, its speed increases by 9.8 meters per second during every second it falls. Thus, in general, a physical law is a relation involving constants between measurement results. Measurements made at different speeds lead to different results. Birds flying alongside a car sometimes seem to stand still. Their measured relative speed is zero. But a pedestrian watching the bird swoop by would disagree and insist that their relative speed was, say, 40 kilometers per hour. The difference between a speed of 0 and 40 kilometers per hour reflects the speed of the measurer. Both the driver and the pedestrian, however, will agree that the distance covered by the birds is given by their speed multiplied by the time taken. Einstein's principle of relativity can now be stated more clearly. He says that while the measurements made by different sets of rulers and clocks will differ and depend on speed, relations between the measurements will be the same for all sets moving inertially. Likewise, any physical constants in law will be the same. Measurement results are relative, laws are not. Using his two principles, the constancy of speed of light and relativity, Einstein made a second astonishing prediction. As Jill's spaceship speeds up, Earthbound Jack will find that its length shrinks. If the spaceship had the shape of a long sausage with fins when it blasted off, at high speeds it will contract lengthwise into the shape of a disc or pancake. For another example, suppose that someone with more money than sense buys a Jaguar on impulse, but returns home to find that the 6-meter car will not fit into the 3-meter garage. By driving the car at nearly the speed of light towards the open door of the garage, it is actually quite possible to fit it snugly inside. Of course, the brakes should be applied before hitting the rear wall. Actually, physicists have found it difficult to confirm length contraction directly. Time aboard a speeding spaceship can be measured by exchanging light or radio signals, but it is harder to measure lengths by pulling alongside the spaceship with a yardstick. However, length contractions is considered a confirmed effect. The famous experiment by Americans Michelson and Morley in 1887 are taken as strong evidence for length contraction. Simply put, they used a long rod moving in the direction of one of its ends. When they shone a ray of light along the rod and reflected it back to its source, they discovered that the ray took slightly less time for the slow speed return trip than expected. Einstein and other physicists concluded that the rod must have shrunk. Just as with time dilation, these contractions seem strange to us only because we are such slow-moving creatures. The fastest human beings run 100 meters at the Olympics in about 10 seconds. If we were many millions of times faster than that, they could flit around the world in a flash. Shrinking lengths and slowing time would be an ordinary part of our lives. On Saturday nights, we could become thinner and dizzy just by constantly rushing back and forth past our dates. But a professor who paced back and forth in front of the blackboard at near light speed might take hours and hours to finish a lecture. To summarize, with faster speeds, lengths become shorter in the direction of travel. This can be put more precisely. Take as a standard a yardstick at rest or moving in a straight line at a constant speed. Other yardsticks moving relatively to this inertial standard will contract in the direction of their travel. That is, the contracted yardsticks will measure only a fraction of the standard yardstick. In fact, the length of all moving objects will contract relative to the standard. Before Einstein, physicists thought that time flows at the same rate everywhere. There was supposed to be, we might say, a universal Tuesday. If it were Tuesday here on Earth, it was Tuesday throughout the entire universe. That is, it was believed that one and the same instant of time occurred simultaneously throughout the universe, and was then followed by the next instant elsewhere at once. Einstein quickly realized that his theories ruled out such a universal simultaneity. This is easy to see. Suppose Jack and Jill synchronize their watches at noon and plan to speak again an hour after. Jill has blasted off in her spaceship. At 1 p.m. on Earth, Jack waits by his radio. But Jill fails to make contact. Jack checks his watch against those of his colleagues in mission control and finds that they all show the same time. Jill is, however, blissfully unaware of her rudeness. Her hour has dilated, and only a part of her stretched out hour has passed. Jill's 1 p.m. is not simultaneous with Jack's 1 p.m. Instead, say, Jill's 12:45 is simultaneous with Jack's 1 p.m., since time flows differently for bodies moving relatively to each other. They disagree about which events are simultaneous. Thus, according to Einstein, simultaneity is relative. Everyone now agrees that special relativity is well confirmed by experiment. But there remains stark disagreement about why length contraction and time dilation occur, about what is going on behind the scenes to produce such startling effects. This may come as a surprise. Einstein's theory is 100 years old. Surely scientists and philosophers would have clearly understood it by now. To the outside world, they present science as a series of great discoveries, a smooth upwards progress towards truth. But inside science, fierce debates and controversies rage constantly. The public is shielded from these in several ways. First, scientific language is often technical and difficult for non-scientists to penetrate. Secondly, science textbooks used everywhere from elementary school to university tend to conceal disagreement. This helps the students by simplifying the material, but it also serves to reinforce the image of science as an objective truth above all questioning, and thereby reinforces the enormous social and political authority of science. Disagreement about the interpretation of scientific theories is normal. No major theory of science is free of debate about its truth, meaning, and implications. One task that philosophers perform is the conceptual interpretation of theories in physics. That is, they exploit their talents for clear reasoning and careful definitions to explore what the formulas in physics mean, to unveil what the symbols say about our world. Physicists today are trained to calculate numbers rather than analyze conceptual arguments, and their verbal interpretations of their own theories are often unreliable. Despite their technical skills, as soon as physicists stop calculating, they are sadly quite mortal. The purpose of interpreting scientific theories is twofold. Science is partly an intellectual quest to understand the world around us, but as science becomes more successful at making predictions, it also becomes more obscure, technical, and mathematical. Thus, progress in understanding the world now often depends on first interpreting and thereby understanding the scientific theories we already possess. The second purpose of interpretation is more practical. Advances in science come in many ways. Some are the result of blind trial and error and summarize when patterns in data are first discerned. Historically, interpretation and conceptual analysis have been one important route forwards towards new theories and better science. many of the important concepts that lie at the foundations of contemporary science were first created by philosophers. Thus, today's philosophers can hope to contribute to our intellectual understanding of the world, as well as to advance towards better and deeper theories. Relativity theory so shocked everyone that many different interpretations of the above effect have been advanced and defended. During the 1920s and 1930s, most physicists accepted relativity theory, and it became a routine part of their work. Controversy, however, raged loudly and ceaselessly. A number of physicists flatly rejected the theory and concocted paradoxes to show that it could not be true and must be self-contradictory and incoherent. Outside science, quacks and disgruntled cranks barraged scientists with proofs of Einstein's theory. In Nazi Germany, the Nobel Prize winner Johann Stark bizarrely condemned Einstein's theory as Jewish physics and used his political power to push research in other directions. In retrospect, those turbulent times were a learning period. Mainstream physicists rebutted the paradoxes and deepened our understanding of relativity. During the Cold War, from the 1950s through to the 1980s, special relativity was gospel. It was considered the best confirmed of theories and provided foundations for all advanced work in theoretical physics. Controversies over the interpretation of the theory subsided and textbook presentations of the theory were standardized. Then came the surprise. Beginning in the 1980s, philosophers and some physicists began to realize that certain experiments were a new and unexpected challenge to our understanding of relativity. That is, while still accepting that the theory worked at a practical level, increasing numbers began to doubt that the standard interpretation was correct. Similar sorts of interpretational problems arise with ordinary maps. A map of the world may be useful for navigation, even though it grossly distorts the shape of the continents and portrays the spherical Earth as if it were a two-dimensional plane. Special relativity makes predictions that turn out to be true, but we can still ask how well it pictures reality. There are many examples in history of theories that made good predictions but fundamentally misdescribed reality. A simple one is the theory that the sun will rise every morning. This theory leads to the prediction of a general brightening in the sky at about 6 a.m, which will be well confirmed. But the theory is false because the sun does not rise. Earth rotates. Two key distinctions, or pairs of words, are at the center of debates over special relativity: relative versus invariant and appearance versus reality. Relative means related to or dependent on something else. When used as a noun, relative means something involved in a relation, which is why we call our cousins relatives. The word invariant is used very often in debates over relativity. In this context, a property is invariant when it is independent of the set of rulers and clocks that is used for measuring it. Suppose that different sets of rulers and clocks are all moving relatively to each other and are used to measure some one property. If all the sets give the same answer, then the property they are measuring is invariant and independent of how it is measured. Physicists sometimes use the word absolute as a synonym for invariant, but history has encrusted absolute with so many different meanings that we will avoid it in these introductory chapters. The philosophy called relativism holds that truth and values depend on personal belief of cultural conditions. Relativism is not the same as Einstein's theory of relativity, as will be discussed below. Einstein's relativity theory does not reject objective truth altogether. It argues that some properties we thought were invariant are not, and introduces new sorts of invariants. In fact, the name theory of relativity was not Einstein's first choice. It was coined by another physicist. The second distinction between appearance and reality is familiar. Hallucinations and mirages are cases where appearance diverge from reality. A straight stick appears bent when half submerged in water, even though it is really straight. This distinction is also central to modern science. Earth appears to be flat and motionless, but science tells us this is not really so. For another example, colors are mere appearance. The atoms that make up the objects around us are colorless and appear colored only because they reflect light of different wavelengths into our eyes. Note that as defined above, the question of whether a property is invariant or not is a question about appearances. A physicist can test whether lengths are invariant merely by making observations and need not speculate about whether those measurements faithfully report what is real. Appearances may have the property of invariance. In debates over special relativity, most people accept that the theory correctly describes appearances. That is, the predictions it makes have so far, without exception, been confirmed. The question that remains is over the reality behind the appearances. What is happening behind the scenes? Can we describe or build models of a world that would explain our observations of length contraction and time dilation? A tennis court appears to have a length of 24 meters, and a tennis match appears to have a duration of, say, 3 hours. Likewise, a shoe appears to have a definite size, and a wink of an eye seems to take less than a second. The key question is about these distances and durations. Bodies appear to have lengths. Events appear to have durations. Are these real properties of bodies and events, or are they mere appearances, like the flatness of the Earth? Or are they something else altogether? Of course, science has no pope. No one imposes uniform views on physicists, and every shade and every variation of opinion on this issue has been asserted at one time or another. Nonetheless, there are two chief answers to these questions. The first is accepted, implicitly or explicitly, by most mainstream physicists. Therefore, for our purposes, call it the mainstream interpretation. This view denies the existence of real distances and durations. More precisely, a body does not have a real length, and an event does not have a real duration that is independent of other things. Since, as experiment and observation confirm, there appear to be no invariant distances and durations, these are not real properties of physical things. For comparison, consider the case of a controversial portrait hanging on the wall of an art museum. This is variously thought to be beautiful, ugly, or indifferent. Suppose that over the centuries, judgments have always been mixed but tended to shift with the prevailing fashions. Some would conclude that beauty or ugliness is therefore not a property of the painting, since the painting is the same but judgments of it vary. The judgments seem not to reflect any inner quality of the painting at all. The mainstream interpretation relies on a similar argument. When astronauts watch a video, it takes 90 minutes according to their watches, but Earthbound observers say it lasted less than 2 hours. Since one drama cannot last both 90 minutes and 2 hours, these durations are not properties of the video. Physicists used a noticeably short argument to buttress this conclusion. Recall that a property is invariant when all sets of rulers and clocks report the same measurement result. That is, if measurements of distances and durations produce different results depending on which set of rulers and clocks is used, then distances and durations are not real properties of individual things, like beauty in a painting. The first premise in the argument, A, is key. It moves from a claim about what we observe and measure to a claim about nature itself, from appearances to reality. This is an excessively big assumption that is, strictly speaking, not a part of Einstein's theory of relativity. It is a part of the interpretation of that theory, the attempt to clarify what the theory says about our world. But the first premise seems reasonable. If a property really belongs to an object, then different measurements should all faithfully report the same result. The second premise, B, is just the assumption that observation confirms the occurrence of length, contraction, and time dilation. That is, it assumes that Einstein's prediction turned out to be true, which is widely accepted. Together, the two premises produces a startling conclusion. According to the argument, relativity theory implies that shoes do not have size. A tennis court does not have a definite length. A tennis match in itself never lasts 3 hours. Of course, the claim that distances and durations are not real properties is merely negative. It makes an assertion about what does not exist. But the mainstream interpretation also makes positive claims about what does exist instead of distances and durations. A comparison will help make this clear. Suppose that at a large family reunion, someone is variously introduced as a brother, son, and cousin. Should we conclude, as in the case of the painting, that these various attributions are not all correct? Since being a brother, being a son, and being a cousin are not the same, should we conclude that the introductions were mistaken? Clearly not. According to the mainstream interpretation, the relativity of distances and durations seems revolutionary only because of an error. We thought that they were real properties of individual things, but actually they are each a kind of relation, technically a projection onto a coordinate system. Lengths vary because they are like family relations to the surrounding bodies and measuring instruments. We mistakenly assume that lengths are properties of individual things only because our ordinary experience involves objects moving far more slowly than the speed of light. Since we are also moving slowly, we all have the same low speeds relative to such objects. Since our relations are thus all the same, we overlooked their key role. A later chapter explains this strange world of relativity further and explores this positive side of the mainstream interpretation. The young Einstein was a rebel, moving from job to job and scrambling to find a secure job. The great father figure in physics at that time was the famous Dutchman Hendrik Lorentz. A generation older than Einstein and a picture of prosperous upper middle class respectability, Lorentz had played a major role in the discovery of the electron, for which he received one of the first Nobel Prizes in 1902. He had come within a hair's breadth of discovering special relativity, and yet always praised and encouraged the young upstart who scooped him. Some measure Lorentz's greatness by his ability to recognize in Einstein an unusual and unconventional genius so quite different from his own. In fact, Lorentz became one of Einstein's earliest promoters and generously helped him find positions that enabled him to continue his research. For his part, Einstein seemed to have idolized Lorentz. He once wrote to a friend, "I admire this man as no other. I would say I love him." Decades later, shortly before his own death, Einstein voiced an extraordinary sentiment about his older colleague. "He meant more to me personally than anyone else I have met in my lifetime." Later in his career, Lorentz loomed over the world of physics as a wise and benevolent grand old man, perhaps the leading physicist of his generation. But historians have been less kind. In the aftermath of the relativity revolution, Lorentz has often been portrayed as a sad figure, with a mind mired in the comfortable past and simply unable to comprehend the dazzling world unveiled by Einstein's theories. The historian Thomas Kuhn wrote chillingly about older scientists who were left behind by scientific revolutions, and quoted the physicist Max Planck, A new scientific truth does not triumph by convincing its opponents and making them see the light, but rather because its opponents eventually die and a new generation grows up that is familiar with it. For many people, Lawrence is perhaps the most prominent example of a great scientist who died clinging to his outmoded theories. His case provided extra evidence to the depth of Einstein's reworking of our concepts of space and time. Even a Lawrence, they say, could not make the revolutionary leap into the strange new world of relativity theory. Today, however, as doubts about the foundations of Einstein's theories multiply, Lawrence appears very differently. We now have more sympathy for his position, and even honor him for clinging to insights that time has rehabilitated. In particular, Lawrence helped begin a tradition of seeking deeper explanations of relativistic effects, such as length contraction and time dilation. While Einstein simply derived these from the principles he assumed, Lawrence insisted that we press more deeply and uncover their causes. He was thus the founding father of what, for our purposes, we will call the minority interpretation. The momentous debate between Einstein and Lawrence pitted two of the greatest physicists against each other. Their respect and affection for one another should not disguise how cutting their disagreement was. Both men had dedicated their lives to physics. If Lawrence proved correct, Einstein's historic first discovery would have denied him. If Einstein triumphed, Lawrence's whole approach to physics, his life work, would be dismissed as old-fashioned, mechanical, and metaphysical. Einstein's mainstream interpretation is dramatic. With a single sweep, it eliminates features of our world that seemed obvious and indispensable and tumbles us headlong into a new world where distances and durations are not real properties. This has been the dominant view since the triumph of Einstein's 1905 paper on special relativity. According to the minority interpretation first developed by Lawrence, however, each object does not have a definite length of its own, but it varies with speed. That is, lengths are real, but variable properties of individual bodies. Similarly, an event such as the wink of an eye or a tennis match does have a definite duration, but the duration will dilate or shrink with speed. A tennis match on a large ship will really take longer than the same match would in a court at rest. A moving clock will really run more slowly. Thus, the minority interpretation breaks the democracy among inertial measurements. It says that some measurements reveal the real distances and durations, while some instruments are distorted by the effects of their own high speeds and report merely apparent distances and durations. Historically, Lawrence and other advocates of the minority interpretation were motivated by the following sorts of ideas. Just as water waves are disturbances traveling through water, they reasoned light waves must be disturbances traveling through some very thin fluid filling all of space. They called this fluid the ether, which is Greek for flame or fire. Although there was no direct evidence for the existence of such an ether, it conveniently explained length contraction. Just as a ship plowing through water will feel a resistance that rises with speed, all objects that move in space are resisted by the ether. Since it is so thin, we are normally unaware of this. But at high speeds, it would pile up against bodies and cause them to contract in the direction they are traveling in. A similar, but more complicated argument explained time dilation as another effect on this resisting ether wind. Thus, the ether is important because it gave a physical explanation of length contraction and time dilation. Einstein and the mainstream interpretation simply deduced these effects from the mysterious constancy of the speed of light and the relativity principle, but do not explain them. In fact, the minority interpretation has a very different view of the speed of light. It is well known that ordinary waves travel at the same speed in the same medium. Thus, waves in water always travel at a characteristic speed. The reason is that each medium has a certain bounciness or elasticity that determines how quickly it pushes back when disturbed. Such a wave is, for one example, a push alternating downwards and upwards, so the degree of bounciness sets the speed of the waves as they progress through the medium. In water, therefore, waves from a high-power racing boat and from a small pebble dropped in a pond both travel at the same speed. The minority interpretation argues that light is just an ordinary wave that travels in the ether and thus really always has, regardless of its source, the same speed relative to the ether. But the peculiar thing about light is that measurements of its relative speed always give the same result. According to the minority interpretation, this is mere appearance and not really true. Actually, the speed of light relative to a spaceship does depend on how fast the spaceship is moving. If the spaceship is moving at half the speed of light, then a light beam racing ahead is gaining ground at only half the speed of light. The relative speed of light only appears to be constant because of distortions due to a length contraction and time dilation. Thus, the minority interpretation removes the central mystery of Einstein's theory by explaining the constancy of light's relative speed, but it replaces it with the mystery of the ether. Mainstream physicists have always been skeptical of the minority interpretation. They have great difficulty with these real but variable distances and durations. Since inertial movement is undetectable, passengers in a cabin below deck cannot tell how fast they are really moving, and likewise we cannot measure our real speed through the ether. Thus, we cannot say how strong the ether wind is and how much contraction is caused. Physicists dislike properties that they cannot measure. The minority interpretation offers neat physical explanation, but introduces unmeasurable and undetectable properties into physics. There is a second, related reason why the mainstream never embraced the minority interpretation. It leads to no new predictions. Although it's quite radical, Einstein's theory is conceptually clean and truly clear, whereas the minority interpretation is messy. It asserts the existence of real but unmeasurable lengths. It asserts the existence of the ether or some other cause of contraction and dilation, but provides no new or independent evidence for it. It asserts that these effects will coincidentally just match those predicted by Einstein, but seems to construct its theories just to produce this match. Physicists might accept this mess if the minority interpretation led to new ideas and made new predictions that would distinguish it from Einstein's theory. But so far, it has not. Before, we needed to explain length contraction and time dilation. We believed that distances and durations were real and constant properties. Now we must choose between two interpretations of these observations. Majority interpretation: distances and durations do not exist as real properties of individual things. A shoe has no size. Minority interpretation: distances and durations do exist and vary with speed through the ether. They are real but variable properties of individual things. A shoe has a variable size. As we shall see, many other important consequences flow from this fundamental difference between the two interpretations. The mainstream and minority interpretation lead to the same predictions. The mainstream interpretation is far more economical and cleaves closely to the results of measurement. The minority interpretation offers physical explanations and realistic pictures of the cause of length contraction and time dilation, but at the cost of introducing into physics unmeasurable properties and a ghostly, undetectable ether.